Thank you everyone so much for coming. As you know, this is the kickoff for the launch of the SoCal Supply Chain Meetup Group. For those that don't know, the SoCal Supply Chain Meetup Group is under the umbrella of a larger organization called the Worldwide Supply Chain Federation. And what that is just thousands of people that are involved in the supply chain across the world, from journalists to technology providers to BCOs, freight forwarders, shippers, carriers, so on and so forth. The largest chapter of the Worldwide Supply Chain Federation is the New York Supply Chain Meetup Group, which we started a few years ago and has a few thousand members. And after moving to Los Angeles, I figured what better place to do a supply chain meetup group other than Los Angeles. So this is the kickoff event. Just would like to thank everyone for coming and for everyone that's helped. Mike and Kevin and myself have been organizing this event, and we hope this is the first of many. And we really appreciate Jim, Braid Theory, and All to See for hosting us today. So I'll pass it over to Jim to say a few words, and I think he wants to just give a quick presentation, and then we'll jump into the discussion. Thanks so much. We have Eric Johnson, who's the senior technology editor at the Journal of Commerce. I really want this session to be an open forum type discussion. This is not just a traditional type panel discussion. I want a lot of interaction, and I want this almost to be a conversation, because the goal of this event is not just to sit here and listen to people speak. It's to really start thinking about the challenges that we face and solutions and how to overcome them. So the more interactive the session, the better. But Eric, I'll let you kind of kick things off. And if all the speakers can come up, I'll let everyone give just a brief 30-second introduction on themselves before we get started.
So Toni said, hey, Eric, do you want to moderate a panel on Saturday? We're launching a supply chain meetup in L.A. And I said, yeah, I don't have anything else going on this week, so we'll just do that.
Nothing else going on.
Yeah, I'm in a moderating mood, though, so it's all good. It's actually great to be back in L.A. This is the first time. I'm from L.A. originally, so this is home, but it's the first time I've been back since the pandemic, so it's awesome to be back here. It's awesome to be connecting with the logistics and freight community again. It feels like we got more done. We just finished our own event, tech event, the last couple days. Mike was there, a bunch of people I see there. I felt like we got more done in 2 days than we did in, like, 8 weeks of Zoom calls, so it's really important to be able to connect. And I think what Toni mentioned earlier is super important about these meetups. I can remember going to some of the early ones in New York, because I'm based in DC now, so I would pop up. And it was definitely not five people, six people, seven people on stage telling the audience what was what. It was a total joint discussion, right? It was everybody sharing with everybody, and maybe the people on stage were making a point or sharing a thought, and then everyone jumped in, right? So there's no barrier between the people facing this way and the people facing this way. It should be totally interactive. So with that, I will stop talking now and let each of our panelists introduce themselves briefly, kind of give some context for why you care about all of this.
Okay, hi everybody, I'm Vipul Shah, and I'm with Next Trucking. I've been with the company for just about a year or so, and relatively new to the industry. Spent the last 20 in the fintech world, working in places like PayPal and Google. So what the heck am I doing? Next is a marketplace as well, connecting shippers and carriers, and looking to build the fabric on which the various players can come back more efficiently together. And so was excited about coming here and building the types of platforms that I've built in other places. So really looking forward to working with the other panelists here and learning as well. So thank you.
Hi, I'm Luis Molina. I'm the founder of Containeros. It's a community of drayage truckers. And just, I want to give my point of view from an owner-operator's perspective. And I'm interested in, like he said, learning more from everyone else that's here. And that's about it.
My name is Matt Schrapp. I'm the CEO of the Harbor Trucking Association. I've been in this job for, well, since June 11th, I haven't been counting the days at all whatsoever. We are a coalition of intermodal drayage carriers. We have every business model under the sun, from employee-based Teamsters, regular asset-based, owner-operator, non-asset-based, the single truck motor carrier. We have sponsors, actually everyone on this panel, I believe, is part of the HTA in one way or the other. So we try to really spread a lot of education and advocacy, helping people understand what really goes on in the trucking industry specifically. We have great partnerships throughout the supply chain, and I'm looking forward to learning a lot too.
I'm David Libatique. I'm the Deputy Executive Director for the Port of Los Angeles. So I oversee stakeholder engagement. I've been with the port for about 10 years. I started off as the Director of Legislative Affairs, and I took this position overseeing community, communications, government affairs about 4 years ago. The port is a landlord port, but we get involved in a lot of the other other policy issues around the port, supply chain congestion, and conversations with the White House and DOT and the governor's office has really been kind of front and center for us. I'm also looking forward to kind of sharing perspective and learning from the others. Thank you for inviting me to be here.
How's everybody doing? My name is Mike Mecca. I'm the CEO and founder of a company called PortPro, and we provide operational software for different nodes on the supply chain. Our first product was a system called DrayOS, which a few of you here use. It's a drayage TMS that's been out in the market for about 2.5 years. It's the fastest growing drayage TMS in North America. We have a couple other products that we're rolling out this year. A little bit of background about myself. I'm third generation in trucking. My grandfather started a trucking company in 1950 in the ports of New York and New Jersey. And worked for my father for an extended period of time, and figured I'd drop my hat into the tech realm. And now I find myself in Long Beach with a great group of people, so I'm excited to be here.
Hi, everyone. Short guy, loud voice. My name is thanks, Braid Theory crew and Toni for putting this together. My background, I'm a maritime guy, went to the Maritime Academy. I sailed on ships for 3 years, so it's in my blood. I'm with Marine Traffic. We're a maritime intelligence provider. I'm here to meet everyone and make some new friends along the way as well, and provide my perspective when it comes to ocean visibility. You know, ships are always out of sight, out of mind, and a lot of what we do is get eyes on those vessels to know what's happening when it comes to all the operations and how it impacts everyone down the supply chain. So thank you for being here.
Cool. Matt, I thought you don't start off your resume with 60 Minute Star.
My mom likes it.
That's what I would start off with.
Yeah, that's the first time I've heard you speak without using
60 Minute Star. Like I said, my mom's not here, so I was trying to stay a little under the radar. But thank you, Don. Thank you, Matt.
So let me start off with maybe a fire starter for a conversation. I was thinking, like, what would be an interesting way for us to sort of frame the challenge and the possible solutions? Because, right, Toni said this is not about who's to blame. It's like, how can we come together? Collaboration, totally overused word, what we're talking about, when there's no substance behind it. So what does it mean? What does that mean? So let's go one by one. And Vipul, I'm going to skip you. I'm going to come back to you because Luis is the most important person in the panel here, right? Like, drayage operators have been overlooked. I've been covering this industry for 20 years. The idea that there would be a panel dedicated to this topic 20 years ago would blow my mind, right? So let's start with you. If you could wave a magic wand and fix one problem that you have right now, not about who's to blame, just one problem that you could fix with a magic wand tomorrow, what would it be? And that's a question for everybody one by one.
That would be, work on that detention time. From my understanding, it's right, we're not here to blame, but in the few events that there has been a blame from truckers to the people we see was within, you know, our view, it's like a blame game of longshoremen. You do this, or there's not enough of you. Actually, that's what they say, there's not enough of us. So long story short, it's a understaffing from what I've been told. So that would be my solution. Hire more guys. There's more than enough longshoremen willing to work. It's just something I've never understood, why there's that, what do you call the terminal operators between us? Like, they dictate how many come in, and it makes no sense, especially now. Like, if you could say the supply chain has a wound, it's bleeding out, and one scenario is like, how can you stop the whole operation for like over an hour every day, twice, because there's two shifts that outside truckers get to, you know, participate in, and that creates a lot of these lines that you see. Once you get back, it's a whole nother world in there. If you get in there before that break, it's different than when you go back an hour later, and that hour is making a big difference 365 days a year. And it's been 2 years of this stuff. So it was bad before, and it doesn't seem like a good idea to stop in the middle of, you know, something that serious.
Interesting. Yeah.
So yeah.
All right. Fair. Simple. Coming back to you.
So I think, you know, when we look at the root causes of some of these types of problems, one of the big things that stands out is just the flow of information and exchange of information across the different parties, right? And the lack of that tends to lead to a lot of inefficiency in the system. And, you know, whether it's, you know, debate around, hey, the container was here, but it's actually over here, right? Leads to demurrage, leads to per diem, not being able to get the accurate information to the carrier, the driver, so that they know where to go at the right time, right? So, right information to the right person at the right time, we think is going to go a long ways to drive the efficiency. And particularly as we look at, you know, the fact that we have such a constraint and a shortage of supply, whether it's chassis, whether it's truckers, whether it's yard space,
labor.
That labor as well, yeah. And that information becomes all the more important, right? So I think just building out the piping and the collaboration around information exchange will go a long ways towards driving.
So your wand is everybody is connected tomorrow morning. We wake up and everybody's connected. Right?
So, and speaking right. The same language as well. Right?
Yeah. Oh, that's two. No, I said one.
One
was
said one. I should.
That.
Magic wand. I'd try to take that magic wand and break it over my knee because I, building on what Luis said, you know, the terminal operators are in an interesting position. They are beholden really to the steamship lines. The steamship lines are the ones who make the decisions about staffing on the terminal each and every single day. And yes, they stop at lunch, they stop for breaks, there's wash up before and after. These guys are sitting around waiting for longshore to come back on break, and those are contractually obligated opportunities for them to take time. It's a dangerous job. No one is saying that they shouldn't be doing exactly what they're doing, but they would, if they hired two foremen, essentially, to have flex shifts where we wouldn't have an hour, that folks would be waiting around. If we didn't have so much domination by the steamship lines in determining not only training of those skilled operators, because casuals are one thing, it's having people in those cranes to work the trucks. You were talking about where the containers are, where the right time, the right place. I've heard from Longshore directly. They get information from the computer, tells them it's in this stack over here. They go and unbury a container to find out that's not the container that they were looking for. It's actually over in this stack and they need to go back over there. So maybe more data sharing. So let me put together the magic wand back together. But I think that data sharing, a seamless amount of data sharing from the time when the appointment is made until that cargo is available, appointments made, cargo's picked up, where it's moving throughout the chain, I think that's probably the best way to go. I mean, we don't want to waste people's time, especially truckers. We're always at the bottom of the food chain, it seems, and when the fingers get pointed, they get pointed directly at the trucking industry.
Dude, that's probably a good lead in, Dave, for you to jump in and say how Port will fix this all, right?
They try.
So, magic wand. First, I wouldn't break the magic wand. I'd probably use a magic wand to create more magic wands.
That's
the best answer.
Like
can't
do that.
Which is true engineer, right here.
Because there are just too many problems to and rifle shot solutions to count. And there is no magic bullet, and we've said it many times. First thing I do is try and create greater empathy across the supply chain. Because, and I appreciate the way that this conversation's convened with no finger pointing, because right now, because the problems are so spread across the entire system, and because the stakes are so high, the system's cannibalizing each other with the solutions it proposes. And that's both from policy to in policy circles, in the media, and so there's a lot of that going on. And
can you give an example of that?
For example, when you talk about gate utilization, right? And if we say there's an issue with gate utilization, that gets interpreted by the public as meaning the truckers are a problem, right? And we need to do something about the truckers. And that's
usually, or there's not enough of them.
Or there's not enough truckers, or it's they can't find the equipment. And so the problem is much more complicated than just saying, okay, this is it. And that's people don't have patience to actually unravel and peel back the layers of the onion to actually get at the multiple problems that are afflicting the entire system. Because one of the things that we get frustrated with is that port congestion is really more of a symptom of a broader problem, right? It's not the cause. And at this point, and we've tried telling the story about how we saw it evolve, but at this point, all the effects are causes and all the causes are effects. So really just pick your place about where you want to start. Data is a good place to start. Data is certainly a good place to start. There is certainly information asymmetry, but I don't think by enabling everyone to plug their data systems into one platform is automatically going to solve everything. There are real workforce availability, workforce resilience issues. One of the ones I would use to convince cargos to pick up more cargo, I'd use the other one to convince the carriers to evacuate more empties and return some semblance of fluidity back to the terminals. I would try and get eyes on what's actually happening inland, because that's where we think the problem began. When Secretary Buttigieg convened this workshop back on July 15th to talk about what are the problems, to a person, everyone was saying, no one's picking up the cargo. We, the railroads were saying, no one's picking up the cargo once it's delivered. The terminals were saying, nobody's picking up the cargo once it's delivered. Where's the bottleneck? And so we all just chalked it up to being a huge consumption surge, and that's probably true. But that is what led to the terminals getting backed up. That's what led to the ships getting backed up out at past the breakwater. And everyone focused on those visuals, and then there was chasing solutions to like handle those visuals. And in the meantime, a lot of these underlying issues aren't really being addressed. So yeah, I'd ask for more wands, because there's certainly more to cut into in terms of solutions, and problems to identify, solutions to be found. But the first thing I try and do is stop the finger pointing.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I think that the magic wand would be to create proper planning, right? And proper planning through data connectivity is really an important step. But I don't think that we even have good data to start planning off of. So to really get to the core of the issue and start making some big changes, I think we need to look at operationally how each company on the supply chain is really running. So I was saying we work with a lot of drayage trucking companies, and somebody could guess like what percentage of drayage trucking companies right now run on like a real like ERP type system, and what percentage run on like Google Sheets or an Excel. Can anybody give me just a ballpark guess of what percentage operate on Google Sheets? 85%. Right, so we're talking about data, and that's across the, and that drayage piece is just one piece of that connectivity. It's a piece that we're focusing on first, but it's just one piece. That extends to brokers and forwarders operating parts of their business on things like Google Sheets as well. A lot of the supply chain right now is running off of shared Excel type files. It's absurd. So I think the first thing my magic wand, planning through data sharing, get to the core of the issue. Let's figure out a way to expose the data, make it good data, and allow the companies themselves to first begin operating better. Because we can't do anything if the core of the people that are, or the companies that are participating with each other are really inefficient. So I think that's the first part. work on that first, and then the other aspects will come over time.
How far upstream does that planning need to start? Like, so if I'm a BCO, yeah. I have a drayage partner, I have the steamship line I'm working with, I have an overseas supplier. Does it start with the supplier? Does it start with the supplier's supplier? Right, like how far up do we go?
Yeah, I think you want to go as high up as you can in terms of planning. One thing that we're piloting now is, so we're rolling out a freight forwarder truck brokerage system, and we've signed up a really big lumber exporter, a company called Ally Global Logistics, second biggest lumber exporter in the United States as a forwarder. And then they've contracted with one of the biggest, or the second biggest lumber BCO in all of the United States, a company called Bailey's Lumber Company up in the Northeast in the United States. Lumber's Bailey Company has put all of their, or is in the process of putting all of their drayage trucking companies onto our system. They're going to be managing all their freight through Ally Global Logistics, the freight forwarder, through our ShipOS product. So Bailey's will essentially have, from the point in time when that export's getting loaded up in New York to the point in time when it lands in Europe or in China or wherever it's heading, complete end-to-end visibility of that product. So I think that's in the ultimate world, as far up the chain as possible. But I think that there's achievable like steps really soon for BCOs and for forwarders to start bringing their own little ecosystems into place and having visibility of at least the point in time when that container's either is leaving that port of origin to the time where it's being returned back at wherever it's heading to. So.
Okay.
Hearing everyone's responses, honestly, my first response is communication. Whether you want to bucket it as data sharing, whether you want to bucket it as what policy is going to have a real good impact, whether it's, you know, is the data there, is it not? Let's communicate how to get the right data. What is missing? Let's have the dialogue between all the stakeholders that are in the supply chain. Because everyone speaks a different language. Standardization, that's a dream. You know, everyone has their own words for certain things, definitions for even just what's an arrival. Ask 10 people, they'll give you 10 different answers. So communication to me is very key, because, I mean, a poll for the group here, how many of you are generally more reactive to situations versus proactive? Raise your hand. I know there's more than that. So that's the problem too. Lack of communication means that you just find out the moment something takes a dump and then you have to react to it. So I think once communication is solved, you know, maybe we'll be more proactive. And then obviously with the one, I'd probably get rid of COVID because I'm sick of it.
That's good. Very good answer. All right, so I'm gonna be like Oprah. I'm throwing out wands here. Who in the audience has a wand? What do you want to fix?
I think if you touched on this a little bit about the you know, you have these unions that are working different schedules. What's the solution to that? Like, there's complexities that you're just describing where there's incentives models not aligned. You use the word domination around, and you know, there's probably truth to that. And so, how do you change the incentive models to really have a continuous flow of cargo without disrupting it? Because I think we've talked about the problem, but like, are there ideas around like how do you actually fix it?
Well, I mean, it's interesting because I feel like the lines have been incentivized extremely lucratively lately, and this becomes the challenge with the contract negotiation coming up. Especially, ILWU is in the catbird seat. They asked for, PMA asked for a year-long extension. ILWU is like, why would we do that? We've worked through the pandemic. We've lost people to Omicron. We've been losing people on the docks. It's dangerous work. I mean, it's a function of incentivization behind movement of cargo. And the problem, as was alluded to, is this communication issue for drayage operators, especially since we're at the last leg of the supply chain, literally, that we unfortunately have to be reactive because the BCOs tell us. And initially, the finger pointing was at, well, no one's grabbing their cargo. Well, the BCOs aren't because they got 33 days of storage on dock from the line that they were contracting with. why would I pick up my cargo? We're always looking for labor, we're always looking for qualified drivers, that's never an issue. But I think incentivizing is going to be a function of how fast can we move the goods to make people money. Everybody just wants to be making money at the end of the day. So to incentivize PMA to train more labor, I couldn't tell you what's going to take to get them to do that. I mean, if they see 24/7 operations as being the answer, has been preached by some others across the bridge at some point in time. We did have a hoot gate. We have one here at FMS. I know the hoot gate at TTI was almost designed to fail. There were so many restrictions that were placed on the operators to be able to go and actually pick up a container at that time. And the restrictions were there because they wouldn't pay the skilled labor for operating from that 3 a.m. to 8 a.m. shift. So I don't know.
Have a dynamic leasing model, you know, to incentivize the carriers in port, where the more output performance you have, the cheaper it gets to rent it? Because like you're changing the incentive models, they have no incentives to like improve.
I think
right?
There is,
and the government's
models like that already.
David
can probably speak to it specifically, but there is those type of agreements already about throughput. Is the more throughput you're doing, the less you have incentives to move that. So I don't know, David, do you guys have specifics relative to incentivizing marine terminals to moving more containers through on a daily, weekly, monthly?
Yes, so there are volume incentives built into the long-term leases that we have. But I think what you're getting to is something a little different.
Yeah, because this volume went up 20%, whatever, last year, right? You're going to hit those.
They're going to hit those, right? Yeah. And they have their MAG, their minimum annual guarantees, et cetera. So all that is, but you're talking about the ports actually playing a more active role in incentivizing efficiencies in different parts.
There has to be two dimensions, yeah. You know, volume and time.
Right. Right, and so we are ready and prepared to take on a more proactive role in gate management, for example. And this is something that we've communicated to the Federal Maritime Commission, who is right now, I think yesterday, had a closed door session to talk about gate management and how Pier Pass is operating as an individual bay.
Sorry to interrupt, but just speak a little louder, you guys, because
yep.
It's really
There's
hard
a lot
to hear.
Of noise here.
Yeah.
We've talked to, dating back a year ago, we've talked to the Federal Maritime Commission about letting the two ports play a more active role in how the gates are managed in San Pedro Bay. So Pier Pass has been around since 2005, I think it was, or 2004. Wikmatoa, which is, my God, the worst acronym ever, West Coast Marine Terminal Operators Agreement. Was established in 2004. They established the Pier Pass, and then they had the off-peak program, which everyone viewed was great because it minimized truck idling in, you know, at a time when that was the focus point. How do we get these truck queues down? And it shifted a bunch of traffic to nighttime hours using a congestion pricing model. So yeah, we have to feed during the day, shift all this traffic to night. But there were always these persistent issues around governance and public accountability, and how do we know the traffic mitigation fee when you increase it is warranted, et cetera, et cetera. So the HTA before your time and other stakeholders, especially the shippers, had always complained, and we thought, well, you know, the ports ought to play a more active role. There are very few really publicly accountable entities in the port complex than the two port authorities. That's really it. If there's a problem, you go to the port authority. Whether or not it's our problem to fix, it becomes our problem to fix. But for what is largely a private sector system. In the case of Pier Pass, in the case of gate management, this is something we've said we're willing to take on more responsibility, and have proposed that to the Federal Maritime Commission. I don't know whether the FMC is gonna hold public hearings about revisiting long-term gate management, but we, along with a bunch of shippers, have asked that be considered, that they look at the ports taking on more of a role, and how do we make sure that the gate management system in San Pedro Bay is actually delivering public value in terms of efficiency on behalf of the end user, emissions reduction for surrounding communities, and competitiveness in terms of what we need to deliver as an economic engine. So that I think there's probably more room for the discussion, and the type of role that you think the Port Authority should play is one that I think we've expressed a willingness to take on.
I got a question about PurePass going back to the PurePass 1.0. In PurePass 1.0, it was designed to incentivize the motor carriers to split their fleet between the day side and the night side. Right now we have a volume of cargo that requires the entire fleet to work during the day side and the entire fleet to work on the night side. We don't have slip seat capabilities there. It just doesn't work right. There's not enough, the night side work volume doesn't really have an economic business structure to allow for a slip seat operation on the night side. We have hours of service that prevents drivers from working both shifts. We have the night side lunch time, which is an hour plus a 15-minute break, put together with a 15-minute coffee break and a cleanup break and a 15-minute coffee break and a cleanup break. They put them together, the next thing you know, you got a 2.5-hour break in the middle of the second shift, which is really detrimental to any driver that wants to wait and say, oh shoot, that crane just stopped. I'm dropping my chassis, I'm getting out of here. I'm not gonna wait 2.5 hours, you know, for a move to my yard because the BCO's warehouse isn't open at 11 o'clock at night or 12 o'clock at night by the time I get out of here. So you've got terminals that are saying, and port authorities that are saying, we have all these all of these appointments that are open and available, yet you have appointments during time slots that aren't really usable for the motor carrier community. You have 2.5-hour dinner breaks that are de-incentivizing motor carriers for working the second shift. And then you have, besides the fact that some of the BCOs aren't open and all you can do on the second shift is shuttle between your own yard and the port. And then you've got PurePass 1.0 that says, we want to take half of your drivers and move them to the second shift, when you really need to have 100% of your drivers working as many as often as they can. You need all your drivers working on the first shift, and you need a large portion of that to work the second shift. Can you slip seat? Can you not slip seat? Is it economically viable? It doesn't seem to be, but there's all these open appointments. And to me, that's frustrating because there's all these open appointments, yet there's no economic capability to run a viable second shift as a motor carrier. And I know the container owners probably agree, saying it's almost impossible to work a second shift and be profitable at it. Right?
How do you, so maybe like the tech providers, maybe Luis, how do you like solve this, right?
I just find it interesting that, and I'm thankful that me as a container hauler can be here discussing with you guys, because in my opinion, it's always been a crisis for container haulers or drayage truckers. And I don't know whose pockets got affected that suddenly, like, it's a crisis, you know? Like, we've been going through this, and I'm thankful once again that I'm here, and I just want to give my two cents.
It's like, oh, so you
could open it 24/7 forever, but what good is it to allow me access to the tool shed if all the tools are missing? Like, and it's all about that ship. So we might have a last free day, and we could literally be doing things right and pull up to the chassis pit so we can get that chassis for that last free day load. But no, it's reserved for the UTRs so they can unload the ship with that.
Yeah, they protect.
Why don't you stack that container that's fairly new and allow the old one to get out and make its way into the chain and get it going?
There's about 800 to 1,000 chassis being used for wheeled operations, whether it's for hazmats or reefers or top tier importers who are paying for that service. There's 800 to 1,000 containers on every single terminal being used every single day. And as a chassis provider, and I see those chassis aren't in the pit, I see they're up at the high line at the ship so they can protect the discharge that needs to go to wheels, or I see that they're on wheels instead of in the chassis pit, and you've got 100 truck drivers in a chassis pit, and
it doesn't
no
make
available
sense.
Chassis.
It seems like things are mismatched purposely, because it seems that there's a lot of profit from this crisis to some, not to us, but to some. I may be wrong, but this is what I read, you know, call it fake news or whatever, but just one statistic out there, Hapag Lloyd last year made in 6 months more than they've made in 10 years. In 6 months.
Well, it's easy if you make $100 over 10 years.
Projection.
Just a scenario.
Projection. Projection. I let Dave.
The moment appointments came up, I thought you were going to jump out of your chair.
it's Saturday.
But that's the issue I wanted to raise. So we do put out figures on here are the available appointments by terminal. And here are the successful and fulfilled appointments, right? And yeah, that leaves the impression that, okay, there is something happening on the LMC side, on the trucker side, that is a problem. But what gets lost in that data, for example, are these issues on equipment availability, on differential rules for each of the terminals, and what the other things that are impacting the rate of successful gate transactions at a specific terminal. And so it's to jump from the success rate by terminal to there's an issue the way that trucking companies are deploying their assets and their drivers. There are a lot of leaps there, right? So there are a lot of things that are going into the capacity, the theoretical capacity by terminal based on the trucking appointments versus the actual utilization rate. And those are the vexing problems that we're still trying to wrestle with. A lot of it has to do with equipment availability. At this point, don't believe it actually has to do with trucker availability, because when we've looked at the gate moves, which we've tracked under the Clean Truck Program for years and years and years, we actually see the same rate, essentially, of utilization over, even through the pandemic. So there's something else going on, and I don't want to just chalk it up to a problem on Matt's side.
I know what it is. Some of those appointments that we as truckers take, we know when we make that appointment, we have no chance of picking up that container. But I have to take that appointment before the last free day, or else we lose our opportunity to hopeful, like there's a Hail Mary shot that I'm gonna get it, but I'm not. So we try to reappoint it within a window that's possible. The assumption that truck drivers will start at any time of the day to go make that first run of the day is flawed. They're no different than you or me. I get up every morning at 5:15 in the morning, I have my coffee, I go to work at 7. Truckers are the same way. If all of a sudden you tell them your first pickup is at 9:30 tomorrow morning, I'm going to say, I don't want to do a 9:30 first run pickup. I want my 7 a.m. one. We're no different than anyone else. And so when you understand why we're making appointments that we'll never get, you have to understand that truckers are creatures of habit too. They start in the morning, they do their first run. There's no way you're going to make a 9:30 second run pickup. It's just impossible to do. So that appointment, unless you can reappoint it, is just going to expire. And then the community says, well, the truckers aren't picking up the freight because 40% of the appointments are going unused. Well, they're going unused because the system is a little flawed. And I don't know what the solution is.
Yep, and unfulfilled, right? So what we've heard is that you have to book multiple appointments, but you don't know where that empty needs to go.
Well, I think to get to his point, I think the issue that trucking companies are facing, and to get to the TMF whole day shift versus night shift, like let's just say 40% of, and Matt might have the exact number, 40% of appointments going used. Trucking companies are just going out on the terminal sites and they're just booking as many appointments as they can book all day.
Some even use fake container numbers, allegedly, for the sake of saving it.
As many as they can book, and it goes unused because there's no the terminals or whoever's really organizing.
Broad. We can't just make appointments. Those appointments are container specific.
Oh, of course, yeah. Right. It has to be available. It has to fit within the parameters.
Right. It's got to fit the parameters.
Absolutely.
So we don't just make appointments. We make them. but we know a lot of them we're going to try and reappoint because the odds of being able to make it. Same as most truckers, we can have all the free appointments we want after the dinner break, but a high percentage of the time, that's a waste of your time because nothing gets serviced after the dinner break. So if you leave at 9 o'clock at night, or are you going to maybe try a hope shot and sit there for 2 or 3 hours and then get something? But it's not a good use of the 60 hours a week that we as truck drivers have. We only got 60. So you can't waste too much time waiting around in the hope that in the evening you're going to get something that's better. So
I think the actual solution to it is actually understanding the appointment scheduling system that trucking companies are working with the ports right now, and being able to recapture the 40% that go unused, being able to predict that they're going to go unused and opening it back up to the market to rebook. That's not really happening until it's too late.
Well, think of a marine terminal like a warehouse. I have a big warehouse, it's got 100 doors. To be effective, I gotta have one truck every 2 hours into those doors to keep goods flowing. The marine terminal is the same way. They need something, they want the appointments, they want to know they got the trucks coming. But at my warehouse, I also have a first come, first serve lane. So in case somebody misses their appointment, I got another guy I can stick in the door. He might be a day earlier or 4 hours earlier. He might have missed something earlier in the day, but he's got a kind of another lineup over here, a queue for the people that need to keep it going. So that's what we do. It would be nice, and I'm maybe oversimplifying the way a marine terminal works, but they have the same challenges as we do. They want somebody there all day, every day. They're only making money when they're moving 50 boxes an hour per handler. So they have a financial incentive to try and move goods. They don't want to see the marine terminal empty either.
So this guy in the corner has his hands up so politely.
Stand up.
My name's Miguel, I'm an owner-operator. I have no business here. The problem that, actually, I want to say, I love your app, PortPro, Next, that's awesome. I really like how we're putting all this technology to make it easier for the truck drivers and for everybody to get their freight out, because that's what we want. We want our shit off the phone. Oh, excuse my language. But one thing that we haven't really emphasized or really pointed the fingers at is it's not really the ILW, it's not really the truckers. Yeah, there's a shortage, but not a lot of people want to drive containers not a lot of people want to drive trucks and deal with all the stuff that we have to deal with. I deal with it night shift because I can't deal with it during day shifts. It'll take me a lot longer than it will during the day than it will during that night. And one thing that I don't find justifiable is the fact that you got these ports that have, I don't know, $1 trillion, I don't even know how much they're worth. But anyways, we're implementing all these technology for the drivers and for the drayage companies, for the shippers and all that stuff. But I'm not going to say the port, but there's a port out there that has the operating system like of an Atari system.
Yep.
Right. I'm not wrong. But anyways, we're implementing all this technology to make it easier for all of us to get our stuff out of there. But how do you justify, or how do you tell me or explain to me, I've been there already 6 hours, and you tell me, oh, the computer systems are down.
Right.
I got more technology in this fucking thing that they do in their computers. So it's not a quick fix. It's not something where you can take out a one and fix it right now. It's going to take time. But to be honest, they need to fix their operating systems, yeah, because of scheduling and everything. I'm going to point them out. TrayPack.
If I can just jump in, one terminal might have amazing systems, but you have to deal with 12 terminals.
Right? They put the money into their infrastructure from the beginning. That's cool. All the systems need to be upgraded. Every computer. How many people didn't have a cell phone that had the antenna or even had the one that went into your backpack? Now we got these. They're still using the same system from the freaking 80s. And then when I went to the trouble window and I'm like, hey, I've been down here for an hour, the phones don't work. Well, we're on lunch. And I'm like, what the? Thank you. The phones at that PCT, the little red ones, they look like they're falling apart. And then TradePack, back to them. How do you, that's one of the newer ports. They went and got their technology from like some knockoff company. I'm not going to say who, but anyways. That's one of the newer refurbished ports. And you're telling me that they don't have enough power to keep the lights on? They have one generator. You know who told me that? A security guard. Oh, why? What's wrong with this? Oh, they don't even have enough power to keep everything running.
But just wait till they electrify everything in the harbor. Just wait till that happens.
Exactly. What I'm getting is that's something that can't be fixed right now. It's going to take time, but they need to invest that money to make things a lot faster. We can't do everything from the outside and try to help them fix their system. We got great technology to be able to get, I'm a little nervous because I'm talking in front of a lot of people, mm-hmm. but they need to be able to do that themselves, because the system that they use, the ILWUs, the operators, the top handlers, how many times, Luis, how many times have you got to your spot and then they go, oh, we need to have another clerk come over here. I'm like, well, the container's right there. Well, yeah, it's because our operating system,
right,
our operating system. Like, give me the fucking top handler, I get it myself. Sorry.
Yes.
Okay, we talked, at the beginning, we talked about data sharing. We talked about empathy. We talked about making all that work for the betterment of everyone, right? So if we try to put this together, right? Port of LA has Optimizer where you can find information that's collected from all the terminals in port, right? Mike's building a system. Triple's got a marketplace. You're giving information about the ship's arrival, right? Why is there not a pipeline already today that connects all of those things so that the appointments in the optimizer are reflecting whether they're actually available or just sort of superficially available, right? Like, I mean, we're not pointing fingers, we're trying to figure out how to make this
all the data's there.
So, yeah.
I wanted to react to a couple of comments. It's really helpful to understand sort of the different perspectives. So at Next, the way we're sort of trying to make this collaboration work is taking some baby steps, right? So for us, it's stitching together the different parts of the container's journey, right? So if we can get, we start talking about appointment optimization with one of the terminals here in the Port of LA. And it was like, how do we optimize appointments? The discussion shifted to, do we even need appointments? What if we had a free flow system and an arrangement, right, where we could stack these containers at the port and know which containers are coming off and have an app that can actually share information with drivers that allowed for real-time flow of container movement. Take it a step further, right? What if we worked with the steamship line and said, hey, look, this is the way you might want to stow those containers on your vessel at the time you're loading them, so that it becomes easier to actually form that peel pile. We know exactly where each container is in that peel pile. And with knowledge about where that ship is in its journey, we can start notifying carriers and secure that capacity, right? So that they're doing the work at the times they want to do the work, and we're making the work available at the time they want to do the work, right? So where we've started, collaboration is a big word, but where we've started is we said, look, let's take the group of carriers that we have on our network, let's take a couple of terminals that are forward-minded and thinking about this in a different way, no appointment. Let's take a steamship line that's willing to share information and influence and allow us to influence the stowage on the vessel. And let's share information across that group of players and also include the BCO in that. And so the model that we've got is one which is a free flow model, where the steamship line is sharing information about what's on the vessel, when they're moving things, what the ports of loading are, when they're going to be arriving. We have information about how those containers are stowed. We're, for the BCOs that are bringing containers on that vessel, we have simpler commercial arrangements as well that say, hey, this is how we can move the containers for you. With the terminals, we have a view of peel pile and real-time exchange of information. And with the BCOs in the warehouse, we say, look, you're going to do a live unload. It's going to be 2 hours. And the same driver that's taking that container there is going to bring back that empty on that chassis so that we don't have a chassis issue, right, with dwell of these containers at warehouses. So the way we're sort of thinking about collaboration is just pick one stream, link those players together, and let's see how that works, right? And so we've moved about 1,000 containers in this fashion at the Port of LA, 2 terminals, 1 steamship line, about 15 BCOs, and we've seen about a 60% reduction in time from anchor to termination of the container. And is it perfect? No. We've run into some surprises along the way as well. But in terms of information sharing, in terms of aligning the processes, this is the first step in a collaboration, right? There's nothing theoretical about it.
So that means you got that much better use out of a truck and that much better use out of a chassis.
Out of a chassis, exactly right, right? And look, this, as a tech guy, I'll tell you, there's nothing advanced about this.
This sounds good, but it's not a scalable solution.
9 million containers that are being moved.
I think it's internal. I think that's like an internal solution, actually. Like for like a specific, I don't think it works at scale.
I don't know about that. I don't know.
Because let's say I'm a trucking company, right?
Gordy in the back. He's got a perspective.
As a trucking company, I have customers.
But that can work at scale when you start looking at that to then find models, and that's where you bring in your AI, because then you're taking that layer to be able to have real data that worked all the way through that you can then build the models that have a better shot of moving forward and scaling. Because everything I'm listening, everybody is reactive on fixing a problem downstream. And what you're talking about is looking an end to end in a proactive way and finding some piece that works. Yeah, that's basic systems engineering.
So of course, a lot of these pop-up yards have a lot of empties that are grounded, and a lot of them have a lot of imports that are wheeled. And when they're wheeled, it affects everybody because that means there's less chassis for the next group of, for the next vessel, the next group of boxes come in. There's very well-known companies been doing nightly dry-offs for years and years, and they've been doing it really successfully. And their drop yards are all wheeled drop yards, and they're 24/7 operations to the motor carriers. You pick up at the drop yard, but you return to the terminal, and they manage their own chassis fleet and use pool chassis as an overflow. Now we're seeing all these other pop-up yards, whether they are for empty returns where the empties couldn't go back to the port. And then those chassis are able to be freed up and used again. But we're also seeing, you know, literally thousands of imports being drayed off terminal to these yards. And I know that these yards are telling me that they're, you know, a 2.2 day dwell before they go off to the BCO. I don't get that gate information in order to know that number is accurate or not. So not having any information, I have to take what I have to take, right? 2.2 days. But are these pop-up yards benefiting the motor carriers in getting their cargo to and from? Is like benefiting the terminals? Because if you've got all that cargo off the terminal, it's got to make that terminal a little bit less congested. And if you've got all that cargo going in and out of the pop-up yards to fill export bookings and things like that, then you're not doing so much gate activity at the terminal. So are these pop-up yards beneficial to the motor carriers? Because I personally kind of think that they're going to be here to stay. I don't think they're going to go away.
I feel like we're missing one huge component of this, which is empty containers. I mean, that's a huge issue for us. And go ahead, Miss. This is a collaborative.
My name is Keisha. I own a drayage company, and I'm going to talk on behalf of the trucking industry. So there's a lot of issues that you guys are not seeing. I feel like there's a lot of blame to be given to everyone. But the problem is that we're not finding a solution. We're having issues from the moment 2021 hit, from not getting enough equipment, there's no chassis. Making appointments. For people that make appointments here, who deals with PRE? Raise your hands. How long does it take you to make an appointment at PRE? Literally, you have to click on that system for like hours to find one appointment. How can we grow as a company when we're sitting there wasting time to find an appointment? The other issue is the lack of misinformation that is given to the public. Let me tell you one thing. There is no shortage of drivers, guys. There's none, okay? There's none. We have plenty of drivers. The issue that we're having right now is the fact that our drivers are spending countless unnecessary hours at the port
been wasting hours to get that one container. We have 50 containers to outgate that week. Guess how many that driver outgated when he used to get 25 containers in a week? He outgated maybe like half of his freight. Why? Because he wasted 10 to 15 hours waiting at the port for maybe 3 containers. And that's on a good day, okay? So for our companies like us, the other issue is the appointment system. How can we ingate all this freight, all these empty containers back when there's no appointment? Like literally none. So we're getting hit with per diems. My company itself, with MSC, we're getting hit with $85,000 of per diem fees because we're not able to ingate the containers. And guess what? The steamship lines don't care. We can go back and, you know, complain about the charges, but they don't care.
They simply ban you, right? That's their solution.
If you don't pay, let me tell you something. You don't pay for that one container, for that steamship line, you can no longer move freight for that steamship line.
Yeah.
So how can we move as a company, as small business owners, how can we move the rest of, or keep our customers happy when we have these huge bills? And the problem, the main problem is here that we're not seeing is no one is taking accountability of the issue. No one is blaming anyone. The moment that we find out who is to blame for this is when we can start fixing the problem. From the point that there's no chassis, there's no appointment, we can't engage the empties, we cannot outgate the containers. There is not an issue about the lack of drivers. There are plenty of drivers. I have over 50 owner operators waiting to work. But guess what? Our freight is sitting on waters, deep in waters, because it's no longer visible for us to see, but it's sitting there. And we cannot outgate it because, for whatever reason, whether it is waiting time at the port, or they're saying, well, the news, for example, right? News are saying, oh, well, there's a shortage of drivers and the companies are not picking the containers. That's not true. Why is that? There is no shortage of drivers. Our drivers are at the port, waiting two shifts, working two shifts. I have drivers that work literally from 8 o'clock in the morning to 2 in the morning, daily, trying to get our containers out. Because we have containers that my company does out of state most of the time, like 99% of it. So for my drivers to be at the port picking up those containers is a waste of time, because with the new ELD logbook, you can't sit there for 16 hours. Guess what? By the time you get your container out, the hours are already expired.
Well, this is the issue, right? It's a productivity problem. It's not a shortage problem. Our members have guys sitting. They can't dispatch them because they don't have chassis. We can't in-gate or pre-gate because of pre-pull, because our yards are full of empty containers sitting on top of chassis that we can't return back into marine terminals. It just perpetuates, right?
Why does that become the current problem?
Exactly.
Do you think
it's not, man. Let's talk to the steamship lines and the marine terminals.
I want to ask her if she thought it was fair that you do your job, point A, you know, the terminal, point B, you do your job, it's empty.
Yeah.
The steamship line didn't want it. Now you're stuck storing it for them for free. On top of that, you pay
store containers everywhere, different yards.
Then you have to prove that it wasn't your fault.
Right.
And then you have to prove it wasn't
your fault. And then shots of your chassis in the meantime. Okay?
Yeah.
Yes. I have one question. Who's in charge for this terminal ship line and the terminal together? Who's in charge? Is it the owner as a ship line, or all together combined and one as decision maker?
So I think what you're getting at, which is what I was going to ask, is okay, I think we're actually all in agreement right here. There's not much disagreement actually, right? There's a lot of frustration, but how do the people that are being impacted by this inefficiency and lack of productivity, whether it's tech companies, drivers themselves, associations representing this, how do we convey to the terminal operators and the carriers that, right, that this is not a sustainable situation?
Without them going like this.
Well,
there's,
I mean,
never
honestly,
been a stakeholder from the steamship lines ever at any of these functions ever.
They're at the Hyatt right now by the pool getting free drinks. That's where they are.
Yeah.
They're even showing up to TPME. So, yeah. I mean, at the end of the day,
some of them are showing up. Some of them are showing up. I've seen the list. They'll be there.
My first foray into the trucking industry was in 2005 when I came and surveyed drivers on turn times at night when PurePass first started. And every driver told me that the turn times are even worse at night than they were during the day. And these have been the same issues for the past 17 years. It's just been exacerbated now by the supply chain crisis and the feeding frenzy by the national media, who can't drill down into the true issues that the drivers are dealing with every day. They just listen to the American Trucking Association, who says there's 80,000 drivers that were short. Maybe there's a shortage in the over-the-road side. There's no shortage locally.
When you think about the first mile, the last mile, the LTL pickup and delivery, the over-the-road, the whole vast amount of truck drivers, maybe there's 80,000 nationwide, but not container port drivers.
Right, it's a productivity issue, Don. We can't stress this enough.
The view of owner-operator, the biggest issue I ran into is price transparency. I've had a situation, I haven't been in the ports very long, but I ran into a situation where I was with another driver, took out the containers from the same port, same delivery location, and he was doing it for half of the price that I was. The worst part of that is that he's been doing that for 14 years. I've only been doing it for, at that point, 30 days. And that kind of broke my heart because we have no way of comparing the prices at all. We don't even know if I'm doing it for the right price or not. Like,
marketplace.
That's kind of one of the issues things that I've ran into.
I think look, it's a very fair point. Over-the-road pricing data, you know, we've got plenty of good data.
Excellent data.
Drayage is so fragmented, and there's so many different variables as well, right? Which terminal, which container. It's a very hard to predict and volatile pricing environment, right? We know that, but we need to address that, right? But just getting back to what are we doing about it, right? If we're not like pointing fingers, to me, the way to do something about it is to do something about it, right? So when we say, you know, who's going to do what, you know, we're looking at it this way and it doesn't scale, it doesn't do this, let's not poke holes in everything that comes up, right? Let's grab a partner, whoever that may be, and let's make a small part of this better, right? So in our world, we're saying, look, we're going to try to verticalize along this corridor, right, of players, and we're going to try to do better by 1,000 containers this week. And if we can scale that, that'll be 50,000 in the next month, right? I think there's just got to be some action, right? And then barring us actually starting to take action, that's all of us. And maybe the guys at the Hyatt. I think there's going to be intervention, which is probably not unrealistic, you know, and I'm thinking about financial services world, which is where I come from, when, you know, 9/11, we all know what happened,
KYC.
And the financial system came to a crashing halt, right, because checks couldn't clear. And suddenly people looking around saying, hey, this is a big risk to the economy. The checks have to fly from one endpoint to another. And now the entire economy is ground to a halt. 7.5% inflation in January, the worst in 40 years. We gotta get our shit together, right? Otherwise somebody's gonna take care of this for us.
People's businesses are going down. Some people are shutting down. It's not worth it anymore. So what if the cost of all this is a higher rate, and the truckers are like, we're done, you guys figure it out, but this is our new rate. Like, that would affect everyone else too, so.
But I mean, there's motor carriers out there who are paying those rates. I mean, it's the guy who's been doing this for 14 years, he's driving this issue. If there's motor carriers out there who will pay higher rates, you have app-based now where you can just wake up in the morning and look and see how much that rate is from point A to B. There's a lot of factors that go into it, distance, value of cargo, etc. But the drivers are in control. You don't need collective bargaining to make this happen. You guys are in control. We all know it. All my members all know it. If you want an employee job to go work 9 to 5, there are those jobs out there. You can go be a Teamster today if you want to be. This is a function of people standing up for themselves and doing what they feel is the most appropriate thing. Driver's times have been getting wasted for ever since deregulation and before then. We are the lowest rung, you guys are the lowest rung on the supply chain, that's the way it is, but yet the most critical link for the entire thing to function. So if you have your guy who's been doing this for 14 years, like, dude, what are you doing? Why don't you come over and haul for this motor carrier who's going to take care of you? Because trust me, I mean, from, I don't know if what you guys are experiencing, but from what I've been hearing, drayage rates are higher than they've ever been. This is what all the BCOs are all complaining
about. It's not taking, not to the truck driver's pocket.
Well, that's debate, to be honest, because if it's not coming to your pocket, it's going to someone else's pocket.
Absolutely.
And it's other drivers' pockets. Yeah. And it's going to find that motor carrier that's going to take care of you guys, period. If you're being taken advantage of, not shame on you, but shame on the fact that people are letting themselves being taken advantage of. And you know what? This is a global supply chain. The dudes are at the Hyatt, who are at the Hyatt right now, the steamship lines, they profit off of all of this. That's why Longshore is like, we're not delaying our contract negotiation. This is our beach, is what they say. As LA Long Beach continues to lose all of their volume, they're going, you look at Charleston right now, there's 30 ships at anchor off Charleston. They don't have the kind of metering that we have where there's 60 ships down in Mexico and off 150 miles out. And we're just in a little break right now because of Lunar New Year. This stuff is going to start cranking right back up again. Absolutely. And the issue for us has been empty container returns. Because if I can't free up that chassis to move that import off of dock, I can't move anything. Everything stops. I'm not dispatching drivers. They're sitting around. I have several motor carriers that I've spoken to who can't dispatch drivers because they cannot find chassis capacity. Whether they're being utilized by the terminals or whether they're sitting in our yards under empties that we can't return back in the terminals. And when you talk to the lines about challenging per diem, they're like, oh, go talk to the terminals. Yeah. We don't control the appointment systems. There's 5 different appointment systems across 12 different marine terminals. And really you could say there's like 12 different appointment systems because each of them function differently. So until we have some integrated, seamless view of the cargo, whether they can figure, I mean, I'm pretty sure there's a science into how they load the ships now. As soon as you put sails into the mix, they say, well, your container is going to be the first one coming off that boat. Yep. So until you can get everyone to agree, if it's only one line, and I mean, should we start talking about vessel sharing alliances? I mean, this, like the FMC, there's a bill in the Senate right now to consider removing their antitrust exemption so they cannot share vessel. Everport, right? It's a green box in, green box out. But you can't return that green box unless it came from Everport or YTI. So, I mean, we're driving all over the harbor. You got to go drop an empty over here, go pick and load it up over here. It's so inefficient. It wastes your guys' time. And until we have some end-to-end solution that gives us that view, until there's one appointment system to rule them all, where you're not spending hours with 4 different, I've sat with dispatch and I've sat with customer service representatives and watched them sit there and hit the refresh button, just hoping that an appointment is going to come available. And then you talk to your drivers, and meanwhile, they have a spreadsheet, right? A spreadsheet of hundreds of container numbers and being like, okay, here's your earliest return date for this container. Here's when they say it's available. You know the container, oh, sorry, it's in a closed area. You can't pick it up.
Also, that's so the little
real quick, so just for the purpose of time, because we have to wrap up now, what is an actionable next step, right? The goal of this is solutions, right? What is an actionable next step for maybe another event, getting certain people in a room? You said she's mentioned steamship lines. What's an actionable next step of progressing in the right direction?
Really quick. I think all the trucking companies here and owner operators, I think you guys should really evaluate internally, right? Like, how am I running independently?
Yeah. Use the outside. Tech that's out there.
Yeah, there's like I don't think as a drayage community, we've really adopted the new softwares that are available today. And I'm talking about softwares that allow you to run independently. So it shouldn't be dependent on, hey, I have to download an app to accept work from here. I have to download this branded app to accept work from here. You should have your own, right? You should have your own visibility. You should be able to run your own business. And all the drayage companies should be running that way. All the drayage companies should be running that way. You shouldn't be running dependent on someone else's software that you're dependent on accepting work from, for example. So I think the first actionable step to solving this is, as a drayage community, cleaning house a little bit inside and understanding how we're running our businesses better so we can, like George, right? Like, run your business better inside, and then you can start addressing and understanding where your voids are and where you're losing money. I think it's really, like, as a community, for us, like, that's our first step. We focus on getting that part done. Then the political aspect, let the politicians worry about that, and we can get involved there. Yeah, let's internally understand what's going on so we can be proactive.
I think there's plenty of space for introspection about, like, improving your internal business practices. There's a real issue about adoption of new technology across the port complex. As Matt said, there are 12 different terminal operators. They have different terminal operating systems. We've been at this since 2016, trying to stand up the port optimizer, getting people to actually put it into one platform, normalizing all the data because they all use it very differently. We've integrated Bounty files. We've integrated EDI 322s, which was a mess. Yeah. And now we're trying to get and incorporate the appointment system. We don't have the appointment system. What the port needs is a uniform port-wide appointment system with common business rules across the entire complex. That's where the attention should be, and where the truckers need to weigh in and talk to the terminal operators and steamship lines is, at the very least, if you want this to continue being a place where truckers want to come, you complain about truckers not showing up, it's because you're not making it easy for truckers to want to enter drayage service.
Get rid of the appointment systems to clean out the port and until you have a single portal appointment system.
Maybe you get rid of the appointment. The appointment system was kind of a half step towards a push system.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe you work towards something that's actually a more seamless.
I think that I would like.
Go ahead.
I would like to bring an example of what we did at my company. So I work for Amazon. And we run a pretty substantial logistic network, as you probably know, right? So we have the same issues with drivers and capacity and truckers that moves from point A to point B pretty much everywhere nationwide. And what we did, we invested very heavily in technology, right? So the first thing that we need to solve the problem of the ports is to invest in technology and bring pretty much every stakeholder at the same level. Because it makes no sense that you have one company with excellent technology and the rest of the companies without good technology. So first thing, terminal operators, shipping lines, PCOs, tracking companies, they need to invest as much as possible in technology. And then you need to empower trackers. You need to give them an application, a mobile application, to be in control of picking up loads, understanding when they need to rest, when they can drive, where they have to go, and also communicate up what's happening. And we did this. We built an application that's called Amazon Relay, which is used by thousands of trackers that are doing business with Amazon, not only our trackers, but also third-party trackers. And this application is making the life of the drivers better, and is making the throughput way higher. So I feel that the problem of ports is, sometimes it's a problem of the shipping lines. I used to work for a shipping line, so they can be blamed for something, but not for everything.
It's easy when you can charter your own ship. I mean,
when you get appointments for the
embassy. So I think that, for instance, the port of Long Beach is doing a great job in investing in technology. They are building a data platform that is going to help a lot in making all the parts communicating together is a first step, and this is what every port should do. They should build their own data platform and share data. So that's the starting point.
If I may, to Tony's point, you know, other action items, you know, alluding to, you know, take control, right? Look internally. Do the research. What else is out there? Talk to your buddy. What else he uses?
While you're waiting in line.
Communicate, but then at the same time, define your KPIs. There's so many metrics.
Yeah.
You gotta figure out, like,
with other drivers can't even leave your truck.
Right.
You'll get kicked out.
It's a serious issue.
So yeah, our accidents have happened recently. Of a driver with hit another driver. Yeah.
Cause that? Like, why are people in a rush?
Our best sources have been social media, especially with Luis. That's how I came across with him. Social media has been amazing for us. Everyone has a phone and an account, so that's been bringing some light on the problems. And I check, like, traffic report. I'll check on there, see what's going on. I'll get on the page and see what's going on. Not go here, don't go there, because there's problems going on. As a driver, that's kind of my update feed. But definitely we can improve.
Thing, and then we have to wrap up. Go ahead.
Has anybody thought about having like a standardized appointment system? Not like, oh, just hear me out, it sounds a little crazy, but everybody has their own systems and everybody's going to do their own thing because it's their business. They're not going to want to have anybody come in here and say, hey, you know what, we're all going to do it this way. They're not going to do it. What about doing like a portal where you could go in there and select, like when you order food, like, hey, I'm going to go to this port, put this empty and this and that. So that way it's one uniform system and then the ports could deal with it from there after that.
It's not crazy. It's the adoption. It's something I wanted to ask too. It's like, there's no incentives when there's so many different technology companies that are going to make money because of all these issues, right? So if everyone is profiting in the short term, right, it's hard to go to every stakeholder to what, it's not like Amazon where you can buy every technology company that's
exactly,
you know, smaller than you and say, okay, every driver app's the same, you're all going to have the same experience across the board. Instead, right now, you have everyone, the steamship lines, Maersk did $5.6 billion in profit last quarter, that's more than Google, right? You have other people who are in the terminals, whether you're in a union where it's your prerogative for your incentives to be met. So right now there's a clash where, how do you, what, talking about solutions, because I want to bring it back to what you can do, right? How do you actually change it so that you drive adoption with stakeholders? How does everyone participate in the conversation to actually make it better and actually improve?
I think those
assistance
are the people that we need to get in a room is kind of what I'm saying. It's, I think at the end of the day, he said the one thing is communication, right? So it's trying to figure out who are the decision makers and getting those people to be in a room like this and... Yeah.
Yeah, the magic wand is everybody shares their information.
Have a standardized way of doing the appointments for everybody.
Well, what does cause the port not to be able to do the gates and such, and to do that kind of management? Could you elaborate on that?
The role of gate management?
Yeah, the political, what are the issues? Why is the port not be able to do it?
It's handled by the terminals. The terminals currently have antitrust immunity to collaborate on peer pass. And that's currently the current regime that governs how.
So is it legal? Is it like in a document? Or?
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, is it like a binding legal thing that you'd have to challenge or something? Because it's support of the truck community, sounds like that's a good idea.
We can work on a blockbuster.
Yeah, we will.
This is good. This was great, guys.
Yeah.
This
was really great. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, everyone, for coming.